The New Warehouse Podcast, hosted by Kevin Lawton, is your source for insights and ideas from the distribution, transportation, and logistics industry. A new episode every Monday morning brings you the latest from industry experts and thought leaders. And now, here's Kevin.
Hey, it's Kevin Lawton with the New Warehouse Podcast, bringing you a new episode today. And on today's episode, I am going to be joined by Andy Johnston, who is the Senior Director of Innovation at GEODIS. And GEODIS is helping you with your supply chain needs, fulfillment, distribution, warehousing, 3PL needs. And we're going to dive into specifically how GEODIS looks at innovation. We're going to talk to Andy and figure out how do you end up in an innovation role, which I think is pretty interesting. Their philosophy for innovation, you know, some of the challenges that they look to solve for, and kind of just what the future of warehousing looks like in Andy's eyes and maybe GEODIS's eyes as well. So Andy, very excited to get you on the show today and welcome, sir. How are you?
Thanks, Kevin. Good to be here. Thanks for having me. I'm doing really well.
Good, good. Happy to get you on here. Happy to talk about this. We haven't had GEODIS on the show before, so I think it's about time we do. So happy to start with you and get you on here. So for people maybe that are not familiar with GEODIS, why don't you kind of give us a brief overview of what it is that you all do?
Yeah, sure. So in short, GEODIS is a 3PL. Mm-hmm. We're actually one of the fastest growing supply chain companies in the United States. Our global headquarters is in France, and our North American headquarters is just south of Nashville, Tennessee, which is where I'm based. We're global end-to-end supply chain, truly from the point of origin to the doorstep of the customer. We specialize here in the U.S. in contract logistics, transport services, and freight solutions. We span over 170 countries worldwide with about 53,000 employees. And in the Americas, we span 8 countries across the US, Canada, and Latin America. And we're operating more than 150 warehouses totaling more than 54 million square feet. So it's always, I think, interesting to hear about how far reaching GEODIS is. And yeah, you know, not necessarily being a household name here in the States, but certainly a huge presence. Of course, you know, putting our name on the Nashville SC soccer stadium here locally certainly helped get us some brand awareness as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, obviously a massive footprint there that you just said, you know, throughout the world internationally and in North America or the Americas, as you said, as well. And, you know, I think it's very interesting to see kind of how that growth has been going and how these things have been developing and, you know, expansion and, you know, especially as the, I guess the consumer changes and, you know, what their expectations are and how that's kind of just propelled our world so much. And obviously GEODIS is growing with that too. And now you've been with GEODIS for about 12 years now, I think is what I saw. And you actually started as an ops supervisor, now senior director of innovation. So I'm curious, like, you know, over those 12 years, because there's certainly been a ton of change in the warehousing world, supply chain, and just world in general in the last 12 years, right? So I'm curious, I mean, how have you kind of seen that change evolve in the warehousing world? And, you know, how have, I guess, you kind of evolved as well from, you know, going from an ops supervisor to now this innovation role?
Yeah, that's a great question. So when I came, as you mentioned, 12 years ago, I was in a facility that was doing retail fulfillment.
Okay.
So we were shipping to retail stores on a daily basis. So it's, you know, essentially just fulfilling the demand that went out of the store the day prior. So we shipped to every store every day, just fulfilling that. So, you know, we saw that pretty typical demand pattern. Of course, there were ebbs and flows as the customer would run a sale or there was a special promotion, things like that. But at that time, we as a company were really trying to get into e-commerce as it was starting to take off, e-commerce and specifically apparel. So we got in with a pretty reputable customer, which helped us establish, you know, our claim to that type of business. And I would say since then, it's taken off on the e-commerce side, of course, both with the industry and at GEODIS. So I spent some time in that operation. I went to another operation where we were doing both e-commerce fulfillment and some monthly subscription fulfillment, which is a whole another nut that we had to crack to figure that part out and understand the, not only the traditional peak period of the Christmas season, but also the intra-month peaks that we had. After doing that for about 2.5 years, I transitioned into a solutions role where I was supporting our front-end sales to bring on new customers under the GEODIS umbrella. So I was doing data analysis. We were doing financial planning and forecasting for those customers, putting together labor plans, equipment plans, designing what we needed the building to look like to handle that business. So did that for 4.5 years about, and then we kind of started on our innovation journey as a company. And that started with a couple of people, and then they were looking for somebody to lead that organization. And so since I had some experience in operations and got more experience seeing different types of operations in my solutions role, I threw my name in the hat for somebody that would be interested in leading that and learning more about robotics and automation. And since February of 2019, I've been doing that. So it's been a fun journey, and nice. Feel like I really got in kind of at the beginning and have been able to ride it here through this just, you know, hockey stick of growth and popularity.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's very interesting, like to hear about that from yourself and that journey. And, you know, it's always fascinating to me, you know, when people in our industry, I think a lot of times, like, you know, people are able to start at like a supervisor role or even a lead or even a forklift operator and work their way up to, you know, be at that director, VP level, even higher sometimes. And I think that's pretty incredible within our industry. And I'm curious, I mean, you know, what was the kind of catalyst or like really the point that maybe stands out to you in the evolution of this business and the evolution of our industry where, you know, it was like a really became that discussion of like, you know, we need some type of innovation team to start looking at some of these newer technologies that are coming out.
Well, e-commerce, obviously, I think was the big catalyst in that the way that orders were fulfilled inside the four walls of the building completely changed. We're not picking cases and pallets anymore. We're picking individual eaches, and these orders are getting very small. And the number of orders that we need to fulfill per day is drastically increasing. So that was one. And then I think that drove some of the companies that we see today to figure out a way to do that process better. How can we fulfill these orders without asking someone to move a cart around a facility, use a RF device, walk, you know, miles per day over an inventory base that probably just keeps growing and growing and growing while we need to keep this stuff on the ground as it spreads out. Now, there's obviously solutions today that have helped solve that, and we're going more vertical. But I think that was the catalyst where the work just became more difficult and we needed more teammates to do the work. So companies were born to find out easier ways to do it or discover easier ways. And then companies like GEODIS and others said, well, let's see what they're figuring out because we're, you know, feeling this need as well. So that partnership just kind of grew and evolved. And now when you, you know, go to shows like a ProMat or a Modex that 6-7 years ago, robotics was kind of, you know, back in the back corner. Now that's all you see. It's just exploded.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's just so many options, you know, it just kind of makes your head spin a little bit when you go to Modex or ProMat sometimes.
Absolutely. But you have to go with an agenda. That's what I tell people who have never attended. Like you need to have your list. Otherwise you'll be lost 30 minutes in.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. Modex this year, I mean, was just like massive, big. Right. But yeah, I mean, I think it's very interesting to hear like kind of that evolution, that thinking to, you know, recognizing that in the marketplace, you know, I guess people are recognizing those challenges that you listed and now trying to come up with solutions. And now how do we, you know, kind of work with them, or how do we evaluate them to see how they can help us with these challenges that we're facing? So, I mean, I'm curious, what is GEODIS's kind of overall approach and philosophy when you start to look at warehouse innovation? Like, how do you look at that? How do you evaluate? How do you decide, like, you know, this is kind of the direction we want to go in innovation right now, and, you know, kind of stick to that in a sense, and, you know, maybe stay away from the shiny objects sometimes.
So if I could sum it up in a word, I would say that our approach is disciplined. We're very strategic about who we partner with to solve these problems. We want to make sure that we're solving the right problem for our customer. You said it well. There's a lot of shiny objects out there, but we take it upon ourselves to find the right ones for the right problems that are going to help our customers. So we've invested pretty consistently over the last few years in automation. We're collaborating with a number of leaders that are out there in the industry to help us with our speed and efficiency in our distribution. I think another catalyst to our earlier question is our customers are wanting to fulfill more for their customers, but they want to do it in the same space. You know, they may have one building or two or three spread out across the country, but they don't want to add space because space is expensive. So how much juice can I squeeze out of the network that I already have? And what technology is out there to help me do that? So kind of going back to our discipline approach, you know, we want to solve that specific challenge. So is our challenge each picking? Is our challenge trailer unloading? Is it replen, put away, pallet picking? What's that piece of the pie that we're trying to go after? And now let's go find that provider that can help us with that. So, you know, we take a lot of pride in finding the right partner. And I use that word very specifically in partner. We don't look at the companies that we work with as vendors. We truly want to create a partnership with them so that, you know, we understand their business and they understand ours, so that ultimately both of us are trying to help our customers achieve their end goals.
Interesting. I love that. And I think it's great to kind of emphasize that partnership there, because I think especially when you're looking at some of these newer technologies, cutting edge types of things, you know, there's a lot of, I mean, obviously, you know, you guys as GEODIS are well established in the space. And then, but some of these companies, you know, are not that old, right? In comparison, like as they're developing these technologies, and, you know, through that partnership, I think, you know, you're able to help them as really like a use case in a sense to help them develop their product so that it fits your needs overall. And then, you know, helps them to build a better product for, I guess, other customers in the long term, so that they're around for a long time to be able to support whatever solutions you have with them. So I think that partnership balance is very interesting there. And I love the fact that you're disciplined in it, and, you know, you're avoiding, like you said, the shiny objects there. And we mentioned Modex and ProMat. I mean, it's full of shiny objects, right? It's like a toy store for warehouse in a sense. But you mentioned a couple of the challenges there too, like that, you know, could potentially come up. And I'm guessing some of those are ones that you're looking at now. But I'm curious, you know, as we talk right now in, you know, about the mid 2024 here, I mean, what's the top challenge right now for you that you're trying to solve for, or that you're looking at like innovations and technology for?
So it's hard to pick a top one. So I'll give you a few. Sure. That's okay. I think these would be, you know, any one of these could be the top, but you know, there's, I'd say four that we really look at. Productivity and labor are probably the two that I think anybody would tell you. The other two are order accuracy and speed to fulfillment. So just starting at the top with productivity, any of these companies, what they're going to tell you is, if you implement this solution, you will be able to pick an order, you know, 2x at the rate that you're doing today, 3x, 4x, whatever it is, which, you know, we've found to be true. If you let a piece of equipment do the majority of the travel, and we're talking about mostly each pick or case pick fulfillment here.
Okay.
And the teammate or the picker is able to stay in a concentrated area and learn that area and know that area and just pick to the next robot that comes to them, they're going to naturally pick more units per hour than they were previously. What I think gets lost there, and you see this with a few companies, but one thing that we really like about using automation is the time to train is drastically reduced from something like I talked about earlier with the a card and an RF device and learning how the, you know, how the warehouse is laid out and where to walk and how to navigate the RF. You know, we've seen training come down from a number of weeks to a number of days. So in those peak periods when we're bringing on a lot of people to help fulfill those, you know, holiday orders at that time, if we can train them in a matter of days instead of a matter of weeks, that's a huge benefit to us and also our customers. The speed factor is going back to e-commerce, right? I need to fulfill it. Or if I'm the consumer, right, I want to click in my cart that I've checked out. And now that I've bought this item, I want it to my house as fast as I can get it. There's two pieces to that. One is the delivery side, but the other is the fulfillment side. So I use this example a lot, but if we're shopping on Amazon and, you know, you're a Prime customer and it says that you can get this order between 3 p.m. and 5 p.m. today, then that's awesome, right? I buy this item, it's going to show up later today at my house. And I think what a lot of people think about is, oh, that driver is going to get to my house quickly. Well, the warehouse, the fulfillment center has to give it to the driver in time to make that cut, right? So from the time that order comes into the warehouse, it needs to get to the driver or to that van very quickly. So the time that we have to fulfill orders is getting smaller and smaller and smaller. So implementing this technology to help us do that is huge, right? We need to be able to do that to keep up with where the industry is going, I think. The labor side, it kind of goes hand in hand with productivity. Labor availability and reliability is not always the best in this industry. We understand that. It's a competitive market. You know, you go into these pockets where there's large industrial parks and there's lots of fulfillment centers and everybody is trying to get, you know, we're working from the same pool of labor. So we want to find the best labor. And once we find it, we want to retain it. So it's our belief that by letting our teammates work with some of this cutting edge technology, we're making their jobs easier and probably also making them more fun and more fulfilling. So when we do get that labor in the door, we're able to retain it for a longer period. And then they can kind of start the journey that you talked about earlier, where, you know, you come in as a forklift operator and you can work your way up and you've been with the company for a long time, really starting that career journey. So those are the big things that we look for that I think a lot of people do when they're looking at automation.
Interesting. Yeah. Yeah. And I think, you know, it's interesting too, because there's almost sort of like a thread there, like around, even though we're talking about innovation and we're talking about, you know, the latest technology, which I think a lot of times that gets caught into this conversation of, you know, like replacing humans or, you know, but really like from what you're saying, what I'm taking away there, I mean, there's this underlying thread there where, you know, you're thinking about the human, right? And how to allow the human to do more, right? How to, you mentioned the training in there, like how to get them trained up faster so they can be more productive and more quickly. You know, how can they be more comfortable in their job? You talked about, you know, taking away, like having to push that cart around. And then, you know, you talked about development overall, like how do we bring them in? How do we, you know, allow them to get started quickly, you know, be able to do their job easily so that they can be effective and productive. And then, you know, how can we start to elevate them too, as well as some of that technology comes in and, you know, there's new opportunities for them to be able to build on and be there for a while. So I think that's really an interesting thing there that, you know, you're trying to solve for some of these things that, I guess at the end of the day, the human is driving on the consumer side, right? But then the human on the fulfillment side is also, you know, trying to keep up with these consumer demands, and you're trying to augment them to be able to push forward and be able to do more. So I think that's really interesting there. So I'm curious, I mean, as you look at, you know, you've been with GEODIS for 12 years, as we mentioned earlier. I mean, if you look over that time and you look as you started to focus more on the innovation side and GEODIS started to focus more on innovation and technology as well, what are some of like the top technologies or innovations that you've been able to put in place or GEODIS has put in place that's really had like a large impact that stands out to you?
We'll be back after a quick break.
I hope you're enjoying this episode. Do you want more warehouse content delivered to your inbox? Sign up for our new email series called Warehouse Wisdom Wednesday to get an educational series of emails on warehouse basics delivered directly to you every Wednesday morning. Find the sign-up link in the show notes.
Mm-hmm. We've had a few milestones over the years. We started back in 2017 with our first implementation with Locus Robotics, probably our longest standing partner, still doing implementations with them today. Mm. So I would say in terms of breadth across our operations, Locus has probably been the biggest. We've seen some great results from them, just mentioning, talking about collaborative robots, you know, that's where we started. We started to move then into some more autonomous vehicles. So we've done the autonomous pallet jacks for the larger unit load movement.
Okay.
We're also working with Vecna Robotics for case picking. Mm-hmm. So Locus is very well known. Six River Systems, very well known. I think there are a lot of solutions out there today that are solving the each pick opportunity. You know, as e-commerce grows, each pick grows. We've talked all about how it's getting faster. Time to fulfill is shrinking. So there's a lot of solutions out there, and we've done a lot of work with those, be it Locus Robotics, you know, Knapp Shuttle System, AutoStore. You know, we've explored a lot of that and implemented a lot of it. You know, we're very familiar in that, and I feel like very mature in that process. But let's not forget about where this industry grew from, you know, case picking, pallet picking. So what we're doing with Vecna Robotics is one of the first of its kind in the industry that I'm aware of, in that we are using a autonomous pallet jack in the same way that you would use an AMR for each picking, where it's taking the pallet throughout the pick area. Our teammates are meeting the robots in the aisle. They're picking to the robot, releasing the robot to continue on its path, taking that travel aspect away from the teammate and allowing them to focus more on picking, getting them off the equipment and letting the equipment do the travel. So that's been something very exciting for us over the past, call it, year and a half since we did an implementation there. And we're kind of getting ready to launch into the next phase of that, which is also exciting. Mm-hmm. Some other areas that are very interesting to us now, it's affirming to go to a trade show like a MODEX. And, you know, we say, well, we're really interested in loose case truck unloading or pallet level truck unloading or more pallet movement within the facility. And then you walk into somewhere like that and you're seeing all these flat top robots moving pallets around. You're seeing industrial grade robotic arms unloading trailers. So it's kind of like you're watching the industry solve one area of the distribution center and start to move to the other areas. So you know, we're kind of just continuing that journey. And I feel like on the leading edge there and being affirmed and what we see elsewhere and in the press and what other people are doing. And then what we're seeing, how we're seeing these companies start to come up with different solutions or new companies pop up that have solutions for some of our other pain points or trouble areas.
Mm. Yeah. I think it's a very interesting point there because it is, you know, I mean, as you look at kind of the robotics journey within the fulfillment and warehouse space. I mean, Locus certainly was like an early standout, right? As one that did that. And there was a ton of focus. I mean, there still is a ton of focus on that each pick, like you said, and now it's evolving more and more. And I think it's very cool, like, to be able to see that, you know, now these other processes that are surrounding the pick process are getting addressed and, like, you know, they're finding out unique ways to do that. I mean, one of the, you know, I've said this several times on the podcast, and, you know, I think it's the unloading, loading process is, like, you know, one that's like way overdue, I think, for automation, because it's just so mm-hmm. taxing on the employee and just such hard work to do that, especially for, like, those floor loaded containers. And, you know, it's really interesting to see kind of that evolution. And it's interesting to hear too that how you've kind of been able to follow that evolution a little bit and start to address that and, you know, work with some of these partners as well. And I think it's interesting to see how they've evolved too, which I'm sure, you know, comes from, like, partner input and customer input and, you know, listening to the voice of the customer, like, what's next? What else do we need to do? And how do we continue to grow this and evolve? So it's great to hear about that. And so we've touched on kind of robotics here a bit, definitely, which I think is certainly a huge theme in the space right now. But the other theme that I think is also, you know, very buzzy and talked about in the industry overall and just the world overall, I think in general, is AI. So I'm curious, I mean, what are your thoughts? What is GEODIS's approach to looking at AI within the warehousing space?
You're right. It is probably the buzziest term of the industry right now. everywhere you look, whatever solution it is, whatever the technology is, it's, you know, powered by AI or driven by AI. So yes, it's front and center right now, without a doubt. So the short answer is, I mean, we're adopting it. I think we have an entire team at GEODIS. It's our data science team, and they are developing proprietary tools using open source AI code to help our operations be more efficient. Probably the two biggest ones that we're using are a labor forecasting model and also there's three: labor forecasting model. We have a tool that allows our operations team to slot the inventory in the warehouse in the most effective way based on, you know, the data that we have about how that inventory has been flowing through the building, how it may flow in the future, you know, new products coming in, things like that. And the third is predictive analytic cycle counting. So coming with the IC background, like yourself, you know, part of that process is, let me do my cycle counts in the facility and make sure that not only my pick faces have the right amount of inventory in them, but also my storage locations. What our predictive analytics tool does is it takes all that data. It looks at, and I'm going to miss a lot of the data points here, but some of them are, when was this location last cycle counted, how much inventory is in the location, what is a typical day's worth of demand out of that location, when was it last picked, and what is our, you know, what's our replenishment frequency of that location. So now our inventory team, instead of counting, you know, just kind of going sequentially through the building, they can get a report that says, here are your highest risk locations to be potentially off. And they can go and target those locations, verify that they're correct or make an adjustment if needed, and then continue on with their normal cycle counting. The labor forecasting model, I think, kind of speaks for itself in the title. We're able to plan in a better way how we need to staff the facility based on upcoming promotions, forecasts from our customers so that we can get ahead of that hiring curve to make sure that we have people in the building when that demand shows up. So yeah, we're, you know, those are some of the ways that we're doing it. On the generative AI side, I think, which is really what put AI into the spotlight, was the chat, you know, the,
yeah, absolutely.
The evolution of chat GPT. So I think that's an important distinction, right? There's AI, which is using data to make a decision or to make a more informed decision. And then there's generative AI, which is actually generating content, which is like your chat GPTs or, you know, how Microsoft is using Copilot to create a PowerPoint presentation from a file that you may have saved in OneDrive, things like that. For that piece, I would say we're taking that disciplined approach, right? We want to make sure that it's the right solution. It's primarily very secure. We handle, you know, tons and tons of data for our customers. So we want to make sure all of that stays secure, obviously. But yeah, short answer is we're embracing it. We're taking that disciplined, consistent approach to implement it into our facilities.
Interesting. And yeah, I mean, you know, my background there in the IC, as you mentioned, and I think that cycle counting application is really, really interesting, because I think that's one thing that I always kind of tried to work around and figure out, you know, because we had like our regular schedule count and separate zones and, you know, all these different things based on velocity. And but that I love is because, you know, sometimes you end up, you know, in a traditional cycle counting way, like you end up counting locations that like maybe really didn't need to be counted, right? Or not really like at high risk, like as you mentioned for that. And I think that's very interesting. So that's, these things are something that you've developed in-house, or these are like solution providers that have, that you're working with?
The three I mentioned have been developed in-house. I've mentioned we have an entire team that's our data science team, and they are developing these things in-house. We have a team here. Cool. In the United States. And then we also have a team that's based in India. So we're truly working around the clock on a lot of these efforts. And they're, you know, that team is fielding requests from operations, from our back office activities, like, you know, accounts receivable, accounts payable. We have a whole transportation team that's doing managed transportation, brokerage. We have freight forwarding. So they're taking all requests that they can right now in an effort to, you know, make not only our distribution center teammates more productive, but also our back office and support teams here in Brentwood and the other offices.
Interesting. Interesting. Yeah. Yeah. You have to show me that cycle counting one time. You got my attention with that one. But yeah, very cool stuff there. And I think it's interesting to see, like, cause that's, you know, I mean, that's one question like people ask me all the time, whether they're in warehousing or not in warehousing, friends, families, like, oh, how are you using AI in the warehouse? I think those are some really great examples there on how to utilize it and how to kind of develop some things that make sense for your operation and what you do. So now before we kind of wrap up here, I'm curious, as we kind of look to the future, right? And I think that's probably a main part of your job, right? Is like, what does the future look like in terms of technology? What do you think the warehouse of the future looks like?
Full of potential is what I would say. Okay. I mean, there are still, I mentioned we've got 54 million square feet of space just in the Americas, you know, not even to mention worldwide, but there's still so much potential out there to make distribution centers, warehouses more productive. And I think that we will continue to see facilities feature more and more automation, whether it's, you know, building wide or pockets like we've been talking about today, you know, the trailer unloading or the each pick or pallet shuttling. Those type of solutions are essentially becoming the cost of doing business, right? It's almost table stakes. Like, our customers expect to see it, and we expect to see it too when we're going after new business or proposing new solutions. So I also think with that humans and technology are going to continue to collaborate together, whether that's on the warehouse floor or if that's, you know, someone in the building that's teleoperating multiple pieces of equipment at once or helping troubleshoot errors for autonomous pieces of equipment to keep them running throughout the day. So, you know, ultimately, I think robotics and automation is going to continue to be used in the warehouse. We're going to become faster. We're going to become smarter. And we're just going to keep changing based on the market dynamics and where the industry takes us. So I'm excited about where it could go. I'm excited about the seat that I sit in, specifically within GEODIS, and just kind of having a front row seat to seeing these companies come to light and being able to implement that into our operations here in the Americas region.
Very interesting. Yeah. And I think you certainly do have a front row seat. I'm a little jealous of that. It's a pretty cool job, if I do, I'd say so myself. So, yeah, I mean, I think it's very interesting to see, you know, what can be happening and just what has happened over the last couple of years. It just seems like we're so rapidly advancing in our industry and our space that, you know, I can only imagine what the next 5-10 years look like. And we'll definitely be keeping an eye on GEODIS to see what you guys do and how you continue to evolve with that and those technologies as well, and what you embrace internally too. So I really enjoyed having you on here, Andy, and talking to you about how GEODIS approaches innovation and kind of what you're seeing in the market out there as well. So I appreciate you coming on. If people are interested in learning more about GEODIS, what's the best way to do that?
Yeah, I would say visit our website, geodis.com. You can find out more about us there. You can look us up on LinkedIn as well. All the information you need is out there. So head out, check it out.
All right, great. And we'll definitely put all that information at thenewwarehouse.com as well. So, Andy, thank you once again for your time on the show today.
You've been listening to the New Warehouse Podcast with Kevin Lawton. Subscribe and check us out online at thenewwarehouse.com.
Enjoyed this episode? Make sure you are subscribed to the podcast, and for more content from the New Warehouse, find us on LinkedIn and YouTube. Links to subscribe can be found in the show notes, and for everything the New Warehouse, head to thenewwarehouse.com.